The Manual of Bean Curd Boxing, Tai Chi and the Noble Art of Leaving Things Undone. Written and narrated by Paul Reed. Chapter 1. More or Less. Besides the noble art of getting things done, there is the noble art of leaving things undone. Lin Yutang. The underlying message of the digital age is that we can achieve more by doing less. However, this mantra for the technologically driven 21st century rarely reaches further than the sales pitch of new age entrepreneurs and gurus who feed us an endless supply of information but a marked absence of wisdom. One explanation is that the less is more philosophy has become detached from its roots within the ancient philosophy of Taoism and the significantly low-tech practice of Tai Chi Chuan. Our Western minds find difficulty in understanding the language of these arts, unaccustomed as we are to the slow pace of its exercises and the brevity of its wisdom. To truly understand the concept of doing less, a new language is required that not only can teach us how to get things done, but to go that one step further and embrace the noble art of leaving things undone. To get out of our own way so that life can pursue its natural course. Bean Curd Boxing speaks of this new language, a language that embraces tigers, that merges with dust, that fries small fish and laughs out loud at the Earl of Greystoke's chest. As with all languages, however, words alone are never enough to stimulate real change. So the Manual of Bean Curd Boxing provides exercises that aid in adopting not just the philosophy, but the practice of real change. The Manual. Chapters 1 to 9 of the Manual of Bean Curd Boxing investigate the ideas that traditionally drive our actions. Our search for happiness, balance, simplicity and health. It is here that we must begin our journey by looking closely at the knots we have tied ourselves into, the bad posture that holds back the power of our breath and the behaviour and patterns of our most recurrent thoughts. Chapters 10 and 11 then take these same ideas out onto the street and shows how we can best integrate these soft yet firm exercises into our daily workflow so that our levels of energy increase, our constitution strengthens, and our pace of life adjusts to a healthier rhythm. The last few chapters provide a contextual history of the arts that make up Bean Curd Boxing, on the basis that the best advice on how to go forward is often to be found by looking back. Benefits of practice. Although this manual cannot promise you enlightenment, you will find plenty of advice on how to keep moving, for in movement there is life. Such movement is found in the pattern of your breath, the pace of your stride, and the softness of your stare. It is found in the flow of air and water, the paths of the planets, and even in the digital exchange of information. It is found in the gentleness of moving forward whilst looking back, and in the process of slowing down in order to arrive on time. And when it's time to get things done, and others around you are bustling with action, you will learn to go and make some tea instead. For it is in the pursuit of unrelated activities that we most often find a solution to our most pressing problems. If all of this appears contradictory, then that is because bean-curd boxers revel in the play of opposites. Throughout the book, you will be encouraged to approach this noble art with a sense of play rather than study, because playing with ideas and exercises encourages you to try before judging. And this is an important stage in the process of letting things go. With play in mind, you will note that each chapter ends with a question and answer session. This is to show that there are no fixed ideas in bean-curd boxing. Everything is in flux. And all good arguments that are worth making are probably best contradicted at some later point. Questions and answers. Soft thinking, meditation, and shoelaces. Question. What exactly is bean-curd boxing? Answer. It is the reclaiming of soft posture, soft breathing, and soft thinking in order to give us back more energy, more rest, and yet still achieve all that needs doing. Question. Soft thinking, is that why it's called bean-curd? Answer. Many people mistakenly believe that there is but one sort of bean-curd, but bean-curd comes in many shapes and forms. Silken bean-curd has the consistency of custard and is therefore far too soft for what we need. Stinky, meanwhile, is just, well, too stinky, and the thousand-layered, despite its Taoist-sounding name, is just a frozen variety, and as such, is far too cold for what we have planned. Instead, as bean-curd boxers, we will be concentrating on the firm variety, for when pressed, it yields and then pushes back, demonstrating an adaptability essential in the world that changes so quickly and so often. Bean-curd boxing, the firm variety, draws on the soft principles of Tai Chi Chuan and applies them to a world that is increasingly digitalized, fractured, and segregated. Bean-curd boxing shows us the path to find balance. Question. Do you have to practice Taoism, meditation, or Tai Chi Chuan to learn bean-curd boxing? Answer. Certainly not. Neither do you need to chant, buy any beads, or map any ley lines. This manual is an excellent starting point for any of the above practices, but it is more than just a manual. The aim of this book is to try and bring the ideas alive, to go beyond the definition of words and beyond the arguments about principle. The aim is, very simply, to provide us with the basic tools to turn life upside down and inside out, leaving you forever changed and forever open to change. Question. What does the art of leaving things undone say about shoelaces? Answer. It's often said that you can't learn something new without first letting go of something old. It's the same with your shoelaces. When your shoelaces are badly knotted, do you carry on tying them into more knots, or do you stop for a moment and say, hey, why don't I try undoing them first? Chapter 2, The Untying of Shoelaces. I have now reigned about 50 years in victory or peace, beloved by my subjects, dreaded by my enemies, and respected by my allies. Riches and honours, power and pleasure have waited on my call, nor does any earthly blessing appear to have been wanting to my felicity. In this situation, I have diligently numbered the days of pure and genuine happiness, which have fallen to my lot. They amount to 14. Abderrahman III of Al-Andalusi, Spain, 960 AD.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.